गुड मॉर्निंग सर एंड गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन. आई एम मधुरा लिमये, कोऑर्डिनेटर ऑफ इंडस्ट्री इंस्टीट्यूट इंटरफेस कमिटी. वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर टुडेज गेस्ट लेक्चर. एज अ पार्ट ऑफ स्टूडेंट डेवलपमेंट एक्टिविटीज एंड कॉर्पोरेट कनेक्ट, IMDR कंटिन्यूअसली एंगेजेस गेस्ट लेक्चर बाय वेरियस इंडस्ट्री एक्सपर्ट्स. सो टुडे अमंगस्ट अस वी हैव डॉक्टर देविदास गोल्हार एज अवर गेस्ट. Sir completed his graduation in BA Economics from University of Mumbai and Masters of Management Studies from KJ Somaiya Institute of Management, Mumbai. Further, he has a doctorate in the field of Industry Institute Partnership. During his 20 years of career, he has served at Mumbai University's Department of Management, Sinhagad Institute of Management and Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. He is also a visiting scholar at Tübingen University, Germany. He is actively involved in teaching, training, industry consultancy, and has undertaken several management development programs in banks, Maharashtra Police, various corporate houses, Ministry of Water Resources, and Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of Maharashtra. He is currently serving as a principal at Marathwada Mitramandals College of Commerce. His areas of interest include corporate social responsibility and social entrepreneurship. As an acknowledgement towards his experience, the Ministry of Higher and Technical Education, Government of Maharashtra, has appointed Sir as a member of the task force to study the implementation of National Policy 2020. Today, Sir is going to talk on opportunities and challenges in national education policy for a B school. So, on a final note, Sir, we are grateful for your presence amongst us today. So without any further addition, I would request sir to take over from here and share his thoughts with us. Over to you, sir.
Good morning. Good morning to you all. And it's really a privilege that get an opportunity to address students of an institution which is pioneer in management education, at least in western part of India. And perhaps I was told once long time back that why is it that the institute like JBIMS didn't exist in Pune? And then people reasoned it out that there was an IMDR in Pune, and that's the reason an institute like JBIMS was not required. I mean, that was really a kind of a good credential and very spoken very high about the institute. And so I'm privileged that I could address the students as well as the faculty member. Rather than I won't call it an address, I would call this as a kind of an exercise, because I have a selfish motive here as well. Because when we are working on the task force, we always look for stakeholders' feedback. And what more? I mean, there are two major stakeholders, that are students and the faculty members. So this, I always see this as a kind of a platform wherein I have a dialogue with all of you, and also try to look at the kind of inputs, apprehensions people have. And I take them as a kind of an input so that we deliberate it on when we meet further. Today afternoon, again, we are meeting. So that's where I come as my selfish motive. So that's the reason I say thank you for this opportunity to have an interaction with every one of you. Now, coming to this national education policy, I'm sure faculty members are aware about it very closely, and students of us also might be. So what I'll try to do is that I'll try to put my sessions into two broader perspective. One is I'll give you what NEP actually entails, and then I'll narrow it down a little on what business schools have stored in for them. I mean, NEP doesn't necessarily discuss about business school, but yes, we can have an interpretation on how business schools are going to get affected with positively or otherwise, what preparedness they need to do so as to keep in press touch with the coming contemporary times. So this is where the two broader things that I'm going to share with you all, and then finally we can take up question and answers. I think we should spare more time in question and answers. As I said, my selfish motive is to get to know about what people think and what youngsters think about this policy, and how do they actually perceive it, and how do they want this to be implemented. So the question answers will come at the last then. Okay, fine. So thank you for the opportunity. And today being April 1st, a new assessment year, let's have a good beginning. Let's try to create all those assets that we perhaps could take credit for in the days to come. What I'll do is I'll, sometimes students, most of us are not very much interested in the history, but let me tell you, history defines the existence and the future. So I'll just very briefly take you through how the policies have evolved over a period of time since since the post-independence era. So Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, who went on to become the second president, when in 1948 he was the vice chancellor at Banaras Hindu University, and he was given the responsibility of shaping a new education policy then in 1948. And under his leadership, the first University Education Commission was established, and that's where the education policies started getting rolled into our country. And since then, there were various revisions, but the broader interventions were done by Dr. D.S. Kothari in 64, and later also came as a policy, as a national policy on education in 1968. So during Indira Gandhi's time. And then it went on having amendments in the form of major amendment was done, because education was center's prerogative, but later on it was also given to state, and that's how in the constitution it came as a concurrent list in 1976. That was a major part for the second constitutional amendment that was brought in. And that's perhaps is one of the reason, even though center has decided on to the education policy, it goes down to the state for deliberation and for the feedback, and collectively they again evolve. So since 1976, this is the exercise that we do. 86, again, it got under revision. 92, again, it got modified, P.V. Narasimha Rao's time. And later on, after that, there was a committee that was constituted under, again, during Prime Minister Modi's time, a committee called Subramanyam Committee, which primarily looked into what needs to be updated or what needs to be changed, reviewed in the existing policy, the policy of 1992. And they started actually doing an empirical study on why we need to change. Because before Kasturi Ranjan Committee was appointed, actually Subramanyam Committee did a wonderful job. And they tried to evaluate why we need to change, if at all there is a need for change. And they came across with various reasons of change. And I'll just briefly share with you one or two, three, four reasons, and that we all perhaps are aware about. One is, what could be the possible reason they felt that 1992 policy need to be changed drastically, what we have coming to picture as a new education policy today. So there are various reasons. One of the reasons that they put across was, and very rhetorically they put it across, that too much that we study is irrelevant in life. Now, this is very interesting, and perhaps most of us in my age group as well as senior to me perhaps agree to this, that whatever that we have studied during school or during colleges, how much of it was really helpful in terms of building our career, in terms of facing the adversities in life. So we studied too many things, but how much of it was relevant to the life? So that was something very, and for the first time it was thought. Otherwise, most of the other policies, earlier policies, were trying to bring in many things as much as they can into the, in the form of a curriculum, in the form of the courses or programs. But Subramanyam on paper, at least formally put it on paper, that do we really need to study this much? Or should we focus on our interest area and try to be more specialized in interest area? Or should we inculcate some more things which are far more relevant in today's context? So that was one reason. Second is, we all know that our entire education is very exam centric. And I would just draw a very interesting parallel to this, that I believe that most of you must have heard about Russian roulette. It's a kind of concept that is explained at many times, and most of the time it is also put it in our Bollywood cinemas, wherein we have a gun wherein there are six chambers, and there's one bullet put into one of the chamber and is rolled in, and then you know the history, how it goes, right? So exams are something like that. Like, for example, if there is like six chapters, and if I study only one or two chapters, and then by luck, most of my question paper is dominated only those two chapters, I score well. If I study only those two or three chapters and my question paper is more dominated with all other chapters, whatever that I have studied, I don't score. So it is more of a luck factor as well, wherein what you study. And as today, we all know the exams are so predictive in the form, like if I look at last 3 years question paper or last 5 years question paper, to a larger extent, I don't need to study the entire curriculum. I just need to focus very strategically, very smartly onto those important things, and then just go across, write them and come back. And if after 3 months or so, somebody asks me, what did I write? I may not be able to recall as well. And that is where perhaps the rote learning also comes into picture. So exam-centric, so it's being learning-centric, instead of being skill-centric, knowledge-centric, it has become more of numbers, it has become more of exam-centric, and that has defied the purpose of the entire education perhaps. Rote learning further has done a lot of damage right from the scoring period. The other thing is, they also came across, there's a lot of commercialization and corruption in education. Now, this is perhaps we all witness, because education somehow in most of the trust, it has become a kind of a revenue generating models. Basically, this trust operates on no profit, no loss, but we all know for sure that there is a lot of profit in education, be it in school or be it in higher education. And then to put it across to the charity commission, to put it across to the income tax, there's a lot of kind of manipulation that goes in terms of to show that we are not profit, we are not generating any surplus. So this kind of commercial as well as corruption kind of approach that is sicked in because of the too rigid policies, perhaps need to be relooked at. Like for example, ISB Hyderabad, they have formally put themselves as a for-profit organization. So let's have a very clear understanding on, are we going to operate for-profit or not for-profit? And if not for-profit, there's going to be some kind of reforms that need to be brought in so that it becomes easy. Like just like, for example, Factories Act and Industrial Disputes Act, and there are many acts as such if you want to start an organization. And the more they are tight, the more there are chances for corruption, because some of the provisions we just can't fulfill if you want to establish any organization. And then you go on bribing the inspectors and then go on bribing the officials. So it's time that we look at some of the watertight kind of rigid norms which are established long time back, some 30, 40 years back. And today what we need, so they're going to need to be have, just like we are talking about labor reforms, and there are some reforms already implemented. So similar in education also, we need to bring in some reforms so as to avoid or minimize corruption or commercialization. I'll come to commercialization a little later again. And the most important, the last reason that I would like to share is, most of our education, we operate in segments, we operate in silos. And hence, it becomes extremely difficult for us to introduce also as to bring an interdisciplinary approach into a multidisciplinary approach into education. So the world is witness to this fact that whatever inventions or whatever discoveries perhaps that are happening, happening because of the possibility of studying interdisciplinary or because of the ecosystem that the university or the country has for interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary approaches. So does our education necessarily facilitate the an interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary aspect? That is something to be thought about, because as of now, if you look at it, we operate in kind of a segment, as I said, engineering education, pharmacy education, architect education, commerce, be it management, so likewise. So there is a need to bring in that interdisciplinary approach, and that also could be one of the reasons why we need to change the policies of 1992 in the form of National Education Policy. So this were some of the reasons Subramanian Committee cited out for why we need to change. And followed with this, Dr. Kasturanjan Committee was constituted, and they went on studying empirically, taking a lot of consultation processes, and based on those, their own empirical studies and the consultation processes. The consultation process, as you can see, it went through several stages and several looks and corners of the country. As we witnessed, like in Pune University, for instance, we had almost like 3 to 4 meetings calling all the possible stakeholders and seeking their feedback before it was implemented. And based on those consultation, the policy was implemented on July 29th. It was approved by Cabinet in July 29th, 2020. And that's how the policy is named as National Education Policy 2020. Now, I just briefly share with you that what structural changes this policy has, because as a student and as a faculty, I believe one should be aware now that if this policy is speaking about several changes, what are those changes and how are they going to impact us and what happens to the existing structural system? So I briefly speak about the structure that are going to come in very soon and what those structures would look like. Again, before getting into it, as I said, Subramanian committee cited various reasons why we need to change. And in addition to that, there was also one of the reasons why we need to change our policy in terms of the most contemporary times. That is the reason of UN. UN has come across with 17 SDGs, which is popularly called SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals. So one of the 17 SDGs, SDG 4, speaks about ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning. Now that is the goal the UN has for all its members. And this goal needs to be achieved by 2030. Now, if we have to achieve, and if you have to really look into terms of ensuring that we have an inclusive and equitable education and quality education, we need to bring in certain changes into the existing policies. And that's how perhaps national education policy was also required. So like we will see to it that how they are trying to target this equitable or inclusive education by 2030. Like one of the examples that I'll also come across later, that in higher education, our gross enrollment ratio is less than 50%, it's perhaps less than 20-25%. In some of the states, it's in single digit. That means people who actually pass their plus two, of the people who pass, they're less than 50% of the students go for higher education. So that's kind of a dropout rate for higher education. So we need to primarily bring that gross enrollment ratio for higher education to 50%, and the target is 2035. Preferably, we can achieve it by 2030, it would be good, because then we actually are in line with the SDG goals. So that's one of the reasons. And perhaps, as I said, we are operating in silos. We are more of rote learning. We are more of exam centric. So from there, our pedagogy has to be more experiential. It's to be more holistic in terms of life and more integrated. More curious, inquiry-driven, more of discovery-oriented, learner-centric. I mean, so these are some of the areas which the policy is going to touch on in the form of curriculum, in the form of pedagogy, and also in the form of the evaluation patterns. So as I said, there are two major rationales, like the shortcomings or the constraints in the earlier policy and the UN pressure for its members to bring their quality education. So that's majorly, there are two reasons why national education policy came into existence. Now, as I said, I'm going to speak about the structures. These are just the chapters, most of the major chapters which the policy document speaks about. We did not get into it in details because in the coming slides, we are going to address some of them. Okay. So what are the regulatory bodies that we have right now? One is we had Ministry of Human Resource Development, which is now renamed as Ministry of Education. So that's already been done. Then we, at this point in time, we have regulatory bodies like UGC, AICT, pharmacy councils, and architect councils. There are too many regulatory bodies that we have, which deals again to the respective professions. Again, there is a segmentation, if you see. So what the policy suggests or recommends is that all those existing regulatory bodies that include majorly UGC and AICT, they'll be dissolved. And they'll be replaced by a single commission, a commission that is popularly known as Higher Education Commission of India. So most probably if you heard last month, Nirmala Sitharaman, the finance minister, have made it very clear that the Higher Education Commission of India would get its cabinet approval very soon. So the day it gets its cabinet approval, the UGC and AICT would be no more. And they would be, either they would be converted, dissolved, integrated, that they are still working on it. So we'll have an apex body known as the Higher Education Commission of India. The Higher Education Commission will have a central advisory board on education, which would be a collective representation of various stakeholders, and they would act as an advisor to the Higher Education Commission. So even though it's operate under the ministry, earlier what used to happen, UGC, whatever they decide is going to be like the final thing, AICT, whatever decide. So they hardly used to be kind of a scrutiny in the form of some advisory council, so in the form of consultation. So maybe what the ministry felt now is that we need to have some advisory body which also seeks as a kind of does a policy interventions or does some corrections even to Higher Education Commission of India. So that body is going to come in. And what we, the Higher Education Commission further will have four different verticals. And these are called the functional verticals. Like we in organization, we have organization structure, which is a functional structure. Similarly, we have four different verticals, functional verticals, and I'll just briefly touch upon each one of them. Like the first one is Regulatory Council, National Higher Education Regulatory Council. Now this council will primarily look at all the possible regulations that the institution has to follow, which have been dictated by AICT as of now, in the form of structures, in the form of the infrastructure, in the form of the student admission requirements, in the form of teacher, qualification requirement, all of those, whatever has been dictated today by AICT, all of those regulatory, there will be a single regulatory council which would monitor or which would guide all the disciplines across India. There won't be any kind of segmentation, pharmacy, architect, or commerce, or sciences, or management, nothing of that sort, engineering. There will be only one regulatory body which will guide all the disciplines. That's one. The second is, if you look today, we have primarily two accreditation bodies. One is UGC and one is AICT. And as we know, AICT is more program specific and UGC NAC is more institute specific. So they are again a kind of loopholes, or they are again kind of constraints in terms of actual evaluation. So again, there's going to be an integration of both of this, and it will come in the form of accreditation council. Now, the beauty about this, which is still spoken and which is still in the draft stage, like for example, if I have to existingly, like for example, NAC, if NAC has to evaluate some institution, the parameters that it has, like Sriram College in Delhi or some remote Ramtek College in Gadchiroli, they have the same parameters. And actually that's a kind of very unfair in terms of the level playing field, because the institution which has a kind of access to the ecosystem and the resources, and the institution which doesn't have the similar parameters of evaluation. And that's the reason, no surprise, Sriram College gets A plus grade, and this particular on the same parameters, the other remote college gets only B or C grade. Because the ecosystem these people have, the challenges these people have on the other side are very different. And I think now at this point in time, this particular council is going to take those differentiations in terms of demography, in terms of the ecosystem, available ecosystem into consideration. Accordingly, they are going to design the parameters and the weightages for each parameters. So that's something which is very welcoming. The third, which is the most important thing, is the Grants Council. Now, at this point in time, if you look at it, the grants are a complete prerogative of AICT, UGC, and some other regulatory councils. Each has its own ways of disbursement, and each has its own ways of putting guidelines for eligibility of grants and the disbursement of grants. Now, this all would be put together, and I'll come to that little later again. There's going to be a National Research Foundation, which is going to be operating under Higher Education Grant Council. So Grant Council job is to lay down certain guidelines, and the guidelines will be very progressive, very contemporary in nature, and then decide on the quantum of grants. And there's not going to be any discrimination in terms of government-owned institutions or government-aided institutions or private institutions. So the grants would be disbursed, or would be the institution would be eligible for grants based on certain parameters, and the parameters are even not out in public formally, but there's a deliberation happening in the form of a draft. I'll just share them, what makes an institution eligible for grant in future. I'll just touch upon that a little later. And the fourth one is the General Education Council. That's where we speak about, today we speak about COs, POs, learning-based outcomes, So all of those curriculum, pedagogy, the dissemination, the evaluation, all of those is going to be the complete prerogative of the education, General Education Council. So irrespective of any discipline, irrespective of any programs. So these are the four verticals which are going to operate independently across all the disciplines and programs in India. That would be completely replacing the UGC and AICTE and all other regulatory bodies. So this is the structure. Very soon you might see the structure coming in. Yeah. Okay. Now, briefly again, what is going to be the status of the existing universities, state universities, central universities, existing affiliating colleges, existing colleges like yours, which is completely an autonomous, or deemed universities? Are they going to be the similar structures carrying in the new education policy? Not necessarily in the same way. So they are going to be broadly three institutions, three types of institutions that would exist in the new education policy. The one which we call as the unitary universities. Now, unitary universities are like central universities. So central universities are already unitary universities, or IITs, IIMs are already central universities, like unitary universities. So they will continue as unitary universities, but in what shape they will continue, that also I'll speak. The second one is cluster universities. Now, Maharashtra is the first state to establish a cluster university. I mean, people from Mumbai or otherwise also, they must be aware about Wilson College, Sydenham College, Law College, Institute of Science, and College of Education. All of those five colleges are located in South Mumbai, maybe in a 5 kilometer radius, and all are owned by government. Now, all of those five colleges are put together as a cluster university, and perhaps Maharashtra is the first stage to do that. Recently, they also appointed a vice chancellor onto it. So these five different colleges catering to different disciplines have come together. Earlier, they used to be affiliated with Mumbai University. Now they have their own identity in the form of a cluster university. The state government has given the name as Dr. Homi Bhabha State Cluster University. So these five colleges have come together. Now this was possible, maybe people may say this is possible because all are owned by government. So in terms of its regulation, in terms of its legal aspect and all that, it was possible. But in days to come, what the policy says is that any single discipline institute or an institute which has less than 3,000 students will be phased out. So if I have to be in the education as an institution, I need to increase my disciplines. I need to increase my student strength to 3,000 plus. And if I individually on my own can't do that, I need to have tie-ups, or I need to have that's where perhaps it is said as cluster universities. I need to bring in, like for example, let's say institute like, even if I may not be very much aware about the details of the Deccan Education Society, but Deccan Education Society as a society could be a kind of a cluster university, or it could be kind of a multidisciplinary institute, because you in the same campus you have various disciplines. Even though you are operating as an institute today, independent institute with independent identity, with different regulatory bodies, in days to come it will be a complete one university or cluster university. Or for example, Deccan fortunately has multiple institutes or multiple colleges, so it becomes easy for them to gather in one umbrella. But what if some of the colleges which has only some of the trust which has only one college, like for example there's only College of Pharmacy and that's it, and it has total strength of student 1000. So those institute will have to necessarily start up new courses or new programs rather, just like for example IITs did, they started social sciences as well. So similarly, any single discipline institute will have to bring in more programs which are of different disciplines, or else they'll have to be in tie up with another college which has offering a different program or different discipline programs. So likewise, the idea is that trying to create an ecosystem, maybe by little imposition in some of the cases, to make it more interdisciplinary, to make it more multidisciplinary. Why is that required? We'll come to that as well. Because only and only if we create a kind of multiple discipline colleges or multiple discipline institute, then only there's a possibility a student may have an opportunity to look into other disciplines along with his major discipline. So this is where perhaps the idea about bringing in either a unitary or a cluster or a multidisciplinary institute. So for example, what happens to Pune University? Pune University is an institution with the concept of affiliation. So no more. By 2035, that's what I'll come to again, 2035, there won't be any colleges in entire country which are operating under affiliation kind of structure. There won't be any affiliation concept. So every institute, like for example, Pune University, eventually will get converted itself into a kind of a central university, like, and it will be called as a unitary university. So likewise, there's going to be three major. So any institution that you pick up in days to come, they'll be either unitary, they'll be cluster university, or there'll be a multidisciplinary institute. If the cluster university is not possible, then cluster, but eventually this is how it will emerge. This is how it will evolve. It will start as a multidisciplinary institute, then it will get into cluster, and that eventually it will get into a unitary university. So again, within the unitary universities, there will be, or multiple disciplinary institute, there'll be three categories. One is, either it will be a research intensive university or a teaching intensive university or just a degree granting colleges. Now this demarcation perhaps is required, or the logic behind it is, it is open for debate again. The logic behind it is perhaps when an institution which has an ecosystem, which has a history of research, let that institution be reinforced into doing more research, and let, as a matter of fact, let that institute be called as a research intensive university. So it's not that there won't be any teaching in this, but in terms of proportion, if you look at it, almost 75% would be research and 25% would be teaching. Whereas against this, there are some institutions where the research domination is little less. So those unitary institute universities would be called as a teaching intensive universities. Like they will have exactly opposite, almost like 25-30% of research, and most of it, major component would be just teaching. And then they will be degree granting colleges, like colleges, most of the affiliating colleges today, eventually based on the accreditation, they'll get the autonomy, and based on the autonomy further, they'll get de-affiliated. And then they will be called as a degree granting colleges. Now this would be a kind of, not a permanent kind of statuses. They would change as per the kind of work the institution does. So a degree granting colleges eventually may be converted into a kind of teaching intensive university, and may be further converted into research intensive universities. Why this demarcation is again required is, when it comes to disbursement of grants, it becomes perhaps easier to mark the institution in terms of their performances. And also it serves as a kind of a motivation for other institutions to get into a category which they wish to get into. So this are some of the major changes in the institution. And as a kind of very ambitious plan the government has put across is that they are going to build up a MERU. MERU stands for Multidisciplinary Education Research University in every district, or one in two districts, likewise, depending on the proximity. Now, this is a very ambitious plan. And as we say, when we say build up, or maybe they identify some of the existing institutions, they convert that institution into MERU, but it will require a huge resource mobilization, not just in the form of financial resources, but also in terms of human resources. Now, this, how are they going to make the provisions, that we'll look into it very soon. As I said, some of the reforms I'll just briefly speak about. One is by 2035, as I already spoke about, 50% of 50% GER has to be reached in higher education. Maharashtra, in a way, is doing good in the sense they are above average. 26 or something, but 26. Some of the southern states are doing good, 26 to 27, above average state. But some of the northern states and northeastern states, they are into single digits. I mean, that means there's so much of dropout in higher education. So that's the primary focus, and that's perhaps is the reason why this establishment of MERU, trying to open more programs so that there would be enrollment based on the interest. Now, when we look at also the reasons, why is it that a student is called as a dropout? Like for example, let's say that somebody enrolls into first year of engineering, and the student gets an impression, or I mean, just comes to a kind of realization that it's not my discipline, and the student drops out. Now that particular student is considered as a dropout, and he's not counted as into higher education enrollment. Now that is sad. In a way, the student get demoralized. The student also loses a year, or maybe some people even, I mean, get dropped out after 2 years. Like, to curtail to this particular problem and this major constraint in the earlier policy, what this policy is trying to suggest is of a flexibility in terms of multiple entries and multiple exits. Now, what does it mean? First of all, the undergraduate programs, as of now, we have 3 year or a 4 year undergraduate program. Like for engineering, architect, we have 4 years, and conventional programs like commerce, BSc are of 3 years. Engineering again is for 4 years. So what the policy suggests is that every program would be will have a provision for 4 years. It will be up to the student to study till the fourth year, or they would like to come out after the third year. After third year, they come out, they get a graduation degree, and fourth year, they get an honors degree. So even a person who has done a four-year program, and when they have to go for postgraduate, they'll have to just study 1 year. So in any case, it's going to be a five-year. So that hasn't changed. Only the combinations have changed. Earlier, it is like 3+2, and in addition to that, it is 4+2. So it was unfair to some of the people. And also, because we are trying to integrate our education to global standards, like in most of the, if you have to go abroad after graduation, usually most of the universities ask for a four-year program. And this way, perhaps some of the problems happen. So in such cases, the student will have the complete liberty. Should I study for 3 years or should I study for 4 years? That's one. The second is there are also going to be integrated bachelor's and master's program, which are already available in some of the, like for example, we have ICER here, then even Pune University has started most of the integrated programs, that is graduation plus PG. MPhil is going to be discontinued. Now, when I say multiple entries and exit, let me come to that. If a student, let's say, for example, gets into a first year of engineering and he realizes that he is unable to cope up, and then he somehow passes that first year and he drops out. So in the existing situation, he's considered as dropped out and there's a wastage of year. But in the new policy, the student, if he gets out of, or he voluntarily, if he gets out of his program of engineering the first year, he'll be eligible for a certificate. That certificate would say a certificate in program in engineering. If a student realizes that after second year that he doesn't want to continue for various reasons otherwise, the person would be coming out after second year, and the person would be not be considered as a dropout, but he will be given a certificate of diploma. So 2 year program he has completed. So the program is, even though it's 4 year program, but 1 year completion, he'll be eligible for certificate. Second year completion, he'll be eligible for diploma. Third year completion, he'll be eligible for degree. And fourth year, be a degree with honors. So today, if I drop out, and if I'll be no more considered as a dropped out, I'll be actually having some kind of credentials with me. And I'll be also accumulating some of the credits, because most of it is going to be credit, right? So first year, if I complete, I have accumulated, let's say, 40 credits. So those credits I have with me, and those credits I can transfer to any other program. And this is where the concept of ABC has emerged in the new education policy. It's called Academic Bank of Credits. Like, just like any other bank, we have the bank where we deposit our credits and we can trade those credits for any other admission in even different programs and different institutions. Now that's something, I'm taking an extreme example. A first year student in engineering drops out, and he gets a certificate, he has already accumulated 40 credits, and now he thinks that maybe economics is more interesting. So he can trade those credits in different institution, not just at the same institution, a different institution, and he can get into a second year with major and minor again. Then after second year, he perhaps realizes, I'm talking of extreme example, people may not do that all the time. So after second year, he realizes that economics is somehow not so appealing to him based on his own skill sets and his own liking. So he thinks that history is more, interesting, or he thinks that maybe law is more interesting. And then for the third year, he gets into a different institution with a different, again, he takes on these credits. Everything is possible because he has a credit and institution would be instructed to honor the credits. So if I'm bringing the certain credits to an institution and applying for a different program, again, based on the availability of the seats and everything, I'm eligible to get into that particular program and that to a different institution. So somebody who did from Delhi, then he comes to Pune for a different program, then he enrolls maybe to Kolkata in a different programs. By the end of the third year, what kind of degree he or she is eligible for? Is because he started with engineering, then he went to economics, then he went to perhaps law. So what degree? I mean, is it law, is it economics, or is it engineering? So in such cases, the policy also has made a provision that the person who is into multiple disciplines have gone into, I mean, institutions can be numbered, that doesn't matter, multiple disciplines, that person would, there's also provision for such person to get a degree in liberal arts. This was the, evolution process. Then we spoke about consultation, multiple consultations were done. Then we spoke about the rationale, that is the UN agenda, Sustainable Development Goal agenda. Then we spoke about the four verticals, headed by the Higher Education Commission of India, guided by the advisory board. These are the four different regulatory councils, the councils of accreditation, education, and grant councils. Then we came to the different forms of structure that are going to be evolved in terms of the existing institute converting themselves to unitary and all those. Then we spoke about the 50% gross enrollment ratio. Then we spoke about, currently we were speaking about multiple entries and exist. So this is where we were, and we were also speaking about academic bank of credit. So far so good, sir. Madam? Hello?
Yes, sir.
We are able to.
Yeah, thank you so much.
So good.
Thank you. Yes, so as I said, so even if somebody gets into multiple disciplines, multiple programs, the person still at the end of it would judge as a bachelor's in liberal arts. So to that extent, this policy is going to have its flexibility. And it will also have a flexibility in terms of if somebody drops out this year, and maybe 3 years later, the person feels that he needs to come back and continue for the second year. Even that is a possibility. So as from this, we can easily understand the approach is to make it more student-centric, to make it more learner-centric, to make it more in terms of going with the pace of the student, going with the perhaps likelihood of the students understanding themselves in the context of the programs that they enroll for. So otherwise, in today's situation, if a student lands in engineering, he or she realizes it's not something which his natural instincts are, and then it's too late. He doesn't want to drop out. And after engineering, in any case, he doesn't pursue engineering career. He gets into some other discipline, and we see that today. I'll come to that as well when we are speaking about management education. The student eventually ends up into a kind of a career which he or she likes, or sometimes they just can't get into a career which they want because they don't have necessary qualification for it. So in this context, perhaps we give them some liberty or some opportunity that even though they need to change in between while they're actually pursuing the education, they can change it and eventually they can pursue what they like to do. So this is, I guess, is multiple entry exit and the academic transfer of credits is going to be a major interventions in the new education policy. Again, very briefly, I'll touch upon those. There's going to be, as I said, National Research Foundation, which is going to be an apex body again, working under Grant Council to disburse various grants. The grants may be in the form of loans, seed capital, or the grants, takeaway grants. So again, there are guidelines that are worked on. The second is internationalization of education. Now, the policy actually speaks about the indigenous knowledge India has, and are we really making an effort to reach it to the other part of the world as to what we were good at and what we can still do? Like, we just boost our credentials in the form of Nalanda, Takshashila, and we were, one of the major hub in education. At least, if not in entire world, at least in the South Asian and Asian format, because there are some evidences to that fact. But today, if you look at it, most of our education is westernized. and we somehow even have come across with the perceived notions that whatever that comes from West is perhaps tested, validated, and it's good. Somewhere the educationists today are thinking about should we continue with this, or should we make now an effort to bank on our own indigenous knowledge and try to bring in that indigenous knowledge into the mainstream education? How that can be done? And if we start doing it in our own country, eventually it will start reaching to the world. So how do we do that? So that is something, the moment we have the Higher Education Commission Bill passed, it will also, the Foreign Education Bill along with that will also be passed. And then we have several provisions made in the policy itself, that wherein the institutes from abroad can have institutions here in different structures, and institutions in India can also easily have their campuses outside. As of now, this provision is there, but again, there are a lot of loopholes, there are a lot of constraints, like a single window kind of clearance could be there in days to come. So the idea is entirely to make us visible across the globe that we also have certain indigenous knowledge, which is very relevant today in the contemporary times. Just a small example, like I was with Tübingen University in Germany, and then even though I was with economics and management program, but even the university spread across the entire town, and when I was walking one day to a different part of the town, and I encountered a kind of a building which had a nameplate of Center for Malayalam Studies. Now, Baden-Württemberg state in Germany has a Center for Malayalam Studies. Now, this, I was very curious, and then I went in and spoke to one or two faculty, and although those faculty, I didn't know Malayalam, but those faculties knew, they were fluent in speaking Malayalam. And then I as a curiosity, I asked that, how is that this came into shape? And then, they told that we were on visit to Kerala, and then we found that you have a kind of rich knowledge. The only thing is the documentation is the issue. And even though there are many things that are documented, but the preserving of it, archiving of it is a big issue. And somehow all those documentation in the form of maybe written on a kind of paper cloth or even on certain kind of old sheets, they had all those sheets and those paper cloths written Malayalam scripts and everything in their own archive. And I was just baffled to see that, how is that our ministry allowed this to be taken out of our own country? It's like a theft. It's an actual theft, right? So they told me that nobody stopped us. And all those manuscripts that we have over here today, we have purchased them into a kind of a local bazaar, just like we have a weekly bazaar here. Some of the parts in Kerala has a weekly. This kind of scripts are available in the local bazaar. So we are so much in love with the Western education today that we ourselves have literally, maybe because we somehow are youngsters, or we as an academician are unable to see a kind of an relation between the education, the indigenous education that existed then, and the contemporary requirement of education today. But there is a relation, but somehow we are imitating what has been happening from the last 4, 5, 6 decades. Or maybe that all happened because we were a colony once. So that is required. And the second thing is, just because we are speaking about how much we adore Western education, I'll just give another example to it. When the Taj attack happened, I was a part of TISS then, and we thought, like three of us thought, that we can go across, of course, under the leadership of Gangopadhyay sir, who was then the head of the department. We went and started interviewing, of course, with the permission, some of the employees of the hotel. You know what, many of you might have read about this now. When the attack happened, the employees of Taj, irrespective of what cadre they were working at, they brought in all the guests possible, whatever was possible, they brought in all the guests into a central ballroom, and the employees encircled the guest. Now, which hotel industry will might have given a training that how to act in a kind of terrorist attack situation, because no hotel might have imagined then that there would be a kind of a situation and how they should be trained in situations like that. But this was more of a presence of mind, one, and this was more of a kind of a belief system, that is Atithi Deo Bhava kind of a system. And this, where did it come from? I mean, and people were willing to give up their life, they risk their life to protect their guest. Where did it come from? So there are a lot of aspects to it. There was a cultural ethos to it. There was a belief system into it. And there was also a demographic aspect to it as well. Because most of those employees that we see, they come from very small town of our country. So we just tried to put across everything together and wrote a case which was available freely. Maybe it was sent to some of the libraries in IIMs as well. And surprisingly, we didn't find there were many takers to it. But eventually later, Harvard Business School, one of our faculty being there, and then they were also wanting to do a research. And then whatever data that we had, we collaborated with them. And then they, of course, they acknowledged it. And then they came across with the same case. And they put it across into their reservoir. And they will take us all across the globe. Forget about all of us, I'm not worried about it. They will take us in India as well. But the same case when was put across by DSS, it was not taken, but it was put up by Harvard Business School. It was taken very enthusiastically. Now, this is where I feel that somewhere we need to reorient ourselves, that we do have our own ways of studying our own ecosystems, our own cultural aspect, our own markets. And we do it better. And it's the fact that the evidence is that people who coming from abroad, they're coming down just to study the markets, the ecosystems, the demography of this country. We ourselves are ignoring it. So this is where perhaps we need to bank more on our indigenous systems so that the people abroad take acknowledgement of it and they also start incorporating. So in future, we should be seeing, like let's say, for example, we study Herzberg. As a part of motivation. Now, I mean, perhaps you're on my mind, you might be able to recall, Herzberg put across two-factor theory. One is the motivation and hygiene factor. So where does the salary come into? Does it come into motivation or hygiene? I mean, in Herzberg's, I mean, concept, it comes into hygiene, right? Wages, salary comes into hygiene. Now, if Herzberg would have known that, I mean, in India, if you look at it, salary itself is a motivation. Is a motivating factor. Now, Herzberg would have never committed that mistake of putting salary into hygiene and not under motivation. Now, these are the kind of differences that actually are cultural differences that we have, and we need to look inside instead of we keep on teaching the students and even students later on trying to come across with the impression. And when they actually go to work, they realize there's a big difference between theory and practice. And this is where perhaps the big difference happens, because we somehow are not able to validate and test what we are teaching our student and what is being there in the curriculum. So, perhaps that's the reason. Sorry, I took it a little away, but it was required, I believe, to just impress on how our indigenous knowledge is far more better, even in the given times. We have to focus more on vocational education. Then this is where perhaps there's going to be already there's a national school, skill quality framework, which is going to closely work at the vocational wing. And from the school itself, there's going to be vocational training. There's a lot of emphasis on vocational training or skill training, but this is kind of a paradox now. The ministry started thinking about having as much as kind of corpus funds disbursed to various agencies, including education institute, so that they start vocational training. Now, if you look at, I mean, at least I have empirical data with me from Maharashtra that many colleges in Maharashtra were given permissions to start BO program, that's the Bachelor in Vocation programs. And they were also given funds, that's a one-time grant as well as the salary grant by UGC. But if we look at most of the centers, that is the most of these Bachelor of Vocational programs, the enrollment is not completely full. I mean, they're in some of the places, less than half. Even in Pune, city like Pune, they're not completely full in terms of the intake. Now, on one side, we are, as a kind of educationist, or we as a kind of ministry, we come across with this thought that there has to be vocational education, and we start putting lots of money. We start coming across with lots of license. We start putting funds. We give permissions, but there are no admissions to these courses. So where are we going wrong? I mean, is it that the program that we run are again in the name of vocational, they are more conventional? Or is it that even though they are actually vocational with all the supporting systems, ecosystems and partnerships, but still there are no admissions to it? Where are we going wrong? So this kind of things need to be studied. It has to be brought in the form of white paper, and then and not only perhaps we can make necessary interventions. Somewhere the answers lies more into the kind of occupational, I mean, skill sets that we have categorized. Like NSQA put across, there are four levels of skill: skill level one, skill level two, skill level three, and skill level four. So skill level four will have less remuneration because these are not the skills which are as complex as skill level one. Who decides that? I mean, somebody who is a shoe manufacturer, how can one say that the person has a less skill than a bank manager? Or a bank clerk who does a kind of some numerical this thing. So skills we have interpreted, and we have put them into certain kind of so-called perceived levels. And because of the certain categorization in terms of the level, people are not very motivated to go for such skills. Like if you go to some of the European countries, even if you go to a barber shop, have a haircut, I mean, it's almost like 10 euros or 10 to 12 euros. I mean, that is the kind of a cost where in India we can have our haircut done for a year. So, I mean, the dignity would come only and only when there is a kind of a social acknowledgement to this particular occupation. And also there is a kind of reasonable or a kind of a justified remuneration for that particular, skill set. And then only people will start going into various disciplines or various skill sets. So that's also one of the reasons people are just shying away. Why would I go into a course of electrician? Why would I go into a course of lathe machine operator? Because they are not valued. They don't have the social dignity, and as much as a kind of a white collar job has. So such a kind of discrimination has to be worked out further, so as people willingly get into such a kind, all those skill set kind of courses. As I said, when we have to bank on internalization, we need to further get into. Now, there is a very interesting debate, and most of the forum that this debate had come across, that the policy recommends that the mainstream education can be given in the local language, that is mother tongue or the other language. Now, is that possible at this point in time? No, because apart from the school education, most of our professional education is not into, the content is not into the local language. So if we have to do that, we have to develop that content. And that's where perhaps the policy recommends that there has to be independent institutes and universities that would just work on content development into the local languages. And in this context, maybe at some point in time, we will have even the mainstream education, the professional mainstream education on local language. But the big question now is that, is it advisable? Is it required? Or will it make any sense in terms of when we are going more towards kind of a global integration? And particularly, if you look at some of the Asian countries and European countries, where predominantly they are offering their entire education into their own language. In the last one decade, they have been very forcefully implementing English as one of the language, so that their nationals are equally good at English. So can we do such a kind of formula? That is to be discussed. National Education Technology Forum, as we see today, because of the pandemic times, so World Bank report that almost in school education, more than 30-35% of, that's again a very kind of low side number, I believe, are completely have cut from the education, and this will have a very long-term impact. The particular generation itself will be completely cut off from education in days to come, and that will have a kind of a generational divide. So can we in a way try to now create infrastructure, technology infrastructure, wherein possibly we can reach to the last remotest person in the society, so that he or she is not excluded because of the lack of technology. So that particular forum is completely going to work on this thing. one more very important thing that many people have this notion that this is the first policy wherein the policy recommends that 6% of the GDP should be allocated to education. Actually, it's not. Since Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan's commission, every commission has put across the recommendation that 6% of the GDP has to be allocated to education, not just allocated, it has to be utilized for education. But till date, unfortunately, otherwise, we haven't reached even to 5% of the figure, or not even some in case 3% of the figure. Even the last budget also didn't, if you look at it, not even 3% of it. So whatever ambitious plans that the government makes in the form of establishing institute, in the form of establishing forums of technology, and establishing grants councils, I guess they would be handicapped if they don't get the required resources. So in days to come, if the policy really has to reach to its intended objective, there has to be funds available and available at the right time. Okay, now I'll come to, there are various other reforms in higher education, but I have spoke about only major ones. B schools, I'll just speak about how things are going to shape. Now, this is my own way of interpreting it. Even the policy doesn't mention about discipline specific changes that it will come through. And this could be because if you look at the management of education in India, it is progressive one, and it is at different stage according to the status of the institute, like central universities, IITs, IIM, standalone institute like yours, then affiliated. So everyone is at a different stage of development. But collectively, when we look at it, what do we need to incorporate? Like personally, I feel management is not a discipline. It's actually a combination of various disciplines. The mother disciplines are like economics, demographical studies like cultural studies, anthropology, even politics. So it's a combination of all those other disciplines, and this is where perhaps it might have started just as a skill building course, skill building exercise, and eventually it got converted into a kind of formal degree programs. But in the process, perhaps did we change as per the requirement? Because if this course existed or came into existence only for the skills, skill building or a skill inculcation, did we really reciprocate to the required skills of the market? And perhaps this is where there are going to be a lot of reforms coming in. Like, I've just randomly put across some of the areas where we need to seriously debate on. This is one of the most wonderful course, the world has perhaps, because there's some very rhetorically they put that master of none but jack of all. But yes, such a kind of skill sets are required. Wherein people may not be expert in one discipline, but they are in a position to join the dots and make a sense out of the situation. So this is where all of those areas are need to be put into the curriculum, are need to be put not just in the form of delivering in the form of lectures, but also in other ways, how this can be more made. Because people who come down to this particular discipline are from various areas. And that's the beauty of this particular program, I believe. So are we inculcating climate disaster, not just as a teaching, but are we really doing something so as to make, not just sensitize our students, but also make them more responsible citizens. So when they walk into their career, that remains as a kind of a dominant factor in decision making. Democracy, rights and social justice, environment is a big concern, and migration today. Is this not a concern? Because if there's somebody who is doing MSc in physics, if you put those migration, poverty, labor, he may certainly shut away and say, that's not my area, and that's perfectly justified. But for management, there's no area which can be said it's not required. To that extent, it has to be open, because every possible decision that you're going to make as a management fraternity in days to come are going to have the fabrics of all of those areas. And this is where perhaps the inclusive decisions and collective decisions are going to be made. So labor reforms, this is one of the most important area that has been discussed in the last 2-3 years time. And some of the emerging like big data, digital data and visualization, how is that going to impact the businesses? How is that's going to impact the common man? And then accordingly, How are the businesses going to be impacted with it? Should we consider terrorism? Should we consider international relations or the volatile markets that are as a major thing? I'm not saying this area are not being touched upon, but they are touched upon as a supplementary thing. But they should be now a mainstream areas of discussion. And then only as a student, as a management student, I feel more evolved, irrespective of which discipline I come from. I feel more evolved. I feel more informed. And I have some opinion to make on every possible aspect. And this is how I would say this is a collection of certain knowledge which helps me in making all the possible opinions and decisions. I believe there's a time now that we need to focus more on experiential learning. Because in some of the NTISs, we never used to call ourselves as a faculty. We used to be facilitators. I mean, I'm talking about 2002-2003. And first year, all of the sessions happens in the classroom. Second semester onwards, 2 days on the field, 5 days, 4 days in the campus. Third year, 3 days on the field, 3 days on the campus. Fourth semester, 4 days on the field, 3 days. So that's a kind of a concurrent placement. And that's perhaps worked out so nicely for TISs. So experiential learning is far more important. And this is going to be possible. And for institute like you, it's more possible because in any case, you are autonomous. But institute like Affiliation Institute, they have certain constraints in terms of disseminating what has been allocated, what has been put onto them. But even though those schools also have flexibility to run as an add-ons, but now somewhere the school have to think about the entire curriculum, the pedagogy in terms of how it is going to be disseminated, and also the evaluation for that matter. How is that going to happen? Are we again going to look at marks? Are we again going to look at degrees and certificates? This is something perhaps is going to be a major, major changer in business school. The other areas is, as we see that many, developed nation management schools, students come down to India to study like the ecosystems of self-help groups, the microfinances. So all of those are like a social schemes of, I would say, the development, social development. What they have to do with studying this particular kind of schemes or this particular kind of interventions. Now, there's a lot of sense to it, and there's a lot of business to that as well in days to come. So, and some of the institutions are already doing it. That's the reason I said when we are talking in general, some of them might be doing, some of them, but majority of them are not doing. So, social immersion interventions, can we have a social immersion projects, which actually a part of that particular curriculum, and it one needs to take up like maybe a 1 month program in social intervention projects. It could be of a World Bank, it could be of ILO, it could be of NABARD, or it could be of any other institution, or even for that matter, standalone independent self-help groups. How is it going to make a difference to the livelihood of the people? Are we going to study that? I mean, because if you have read about C.K. Prahlad, he speaks about the bottom of the pyramid. Unless until those bottom of the pyramids are empowered in terms of their financial independence, I don't think that they're going to be businesses in terms of their growth and sustenance in days to come. So this is where the interventions are required. And these school students are not doing the social work here, because when they go to the field, they look at it more from a professional perspective, from perspective of livelihood, from perspective of generating the wealth, as against the conventional social work students. So there's a difference in these approaches. And that's the reason our students need to take those kind of programs. There's a rise in finishing schools. Most of the corporates, if you look at it, be it Infosys, Mahindra, they're taking up their own finishing schools, because as we hear from some of the corporates, I mean, at least what I have heard is that at the end of the day, when we take student, we just look at the aptitude. And anyway, we have to train the student. And when I say aptitude, the corporates, recruiters intervene aptitude in the form of how quick the person can learn. That's an aptitude for them. So then we put them into 6 months kind of training, or maybe 1 year kind of training. So might as well be, instead of coming down to a B schools and recruiting management graduates and putting them into training again, we might take graduates and put them into a 6 months kind of training, which is very customized. And those kind of products are far more, perhaps reasonably in terms of CTC, and also more eligible, because they don't need any unlearning to be done. I mean, the state can be conditioned to the requirement of the jobs. So this is where the finishing schools, as long as the management education institutes are not trying to be more contemporary in terms of the required skills into the market. Perhaps the corporates will take things into their control and they'll start establishing finished schools, or they may start establishing finishing schools in cooperation with some existing management institute. So that's going to be one of the major change, I believe. More contemporary and industry specific disciplines. And this is where I say the tie-ups. And like, for example, IIM runs a program for Axis Bank. So likewise, there is a possibility that we don't need to all the time look into a kind of conventional student, fresh student courses or programs. We also need to very seriously think about adult education in management. Days where we have been laying a lot of emphasis on entrepreneurship, but can we try to look at social entrepreneurship as one of the major avenue for intervention? Because we see that a lot of good examples that have come in the recent times of social entrepreneurship, wherein it's not again a kind of philanthropy, it's actually a business. But businesses keeping all the stakeholders intact, and this would perhaps in the long run, the more the small social entrepreneurs we create, the more it would be sustainable, the more it would be equitable distribution of wealth, and the more it would be increasing on the development indicators. So this is where I look at it, social entrepreneurship. The other thing is, how much time do I have, ma'am? Have I exceeded?
No issues, sir. It's okay, sir.
Okay, please just tell me 5 minutes before so that I'll wrap it up. The other thing is, there's a very interesting debate that's happening in the West, and please allow me to share this with you. There's an increased feeling that within the technocrats, when I say technocrats, I mean all those be engineers, most of it, they have this feeling that they have been robbed of their share of contribution. And it has been robbed by management professions. I mean, this is a feeling. I'm not advocating any feeling over here. I'm just sharing that feeling with you. So in the days, from the last almost one or two decades, this is the increased feeling among the technocrat that it's we who actually add value to the product. It's we who design the products. It's we who re-engineer it. And how much of share that we get out of this particular work that we, in the form of salaries, perks, whatever. As against people who are more as a facilitator. And when I say facilitator, I mean a guy who is doing marketing of that particular product, guy who is trying to arrange finances for this particular product, a guy who is also trying to keep human resources and the supply chain intact. So all those supportive functions. So are those supportive functions more paid in terms of their contribution to the product, as against the contribution the technocrats make? So this is a very interesting debate, and there's a sense in the debate. That's my personal opinion. So, and that perhaps is evident from the fact that no engineer would like to continue his career in engineering. He or she would like to come into management and then take a course in management and get into management profession, because the jobs are more perhaps has a higher dignity. It also has a higher pay. Now, if somebody is, I don't want to get very much details into it, because it itself can be a 1 hour, 1.5 hour kind of a topic to discuss about. But what I'm trying to tell you here is that there's a lot of rationalization that is happening in the profiles of the supportive functions or facilitative functions of management. In days to come, perhaps there's, like, for example, there was a situation in Infosys wherein they wanted some HR people, and they tried few institutions, but somehow they found that it's not happening in terms of what the requirement of the profile is. And then just simply floated the requirement, whoever is interested to make their career into human resources, who has people skills, can just voluntarily apply. And the technocrats, the engineers, line managers in a kind of conventional sense, they are the some of them who applied to it, and they were put with for 6 months of rigorous training in association with IIM Bangalore, if I'm not wrong. And these are the people today who are heading all the top positions in HR in Infosys. Now, this is where perhaps technocrats, are they doing better, not just in their own discipline, but also they prove to be better when they come to facilitative functions, Now, this is the debate the organization is undergoing. And perhaps that's in manufacturing anyway, it is happening. Because if you look at it, for example, take any, for example, take JBMS, for example. Like earlier days, it used to be a prestige for telco as well as for Larsen & Toubro to be listed as the first day, first company in a campus week. Because that day, sometimes I have even seen a Larsen & Toubro writing in their report that we are the most preferred company at JBIMS campus. But today, Larsen & Toubro doesn't even visit JBIMS for their campus. Now, this shift has happened. Now, why this shift has happened? I mean, some people may argue that there's a heavy, there's a growth of service sector, and that's where the service sectors are major recruiters today. Fine, that could be a possibility. But again, are we laying a heavy dependence in terms of not only in terms of employment, but also in terms of revenue on service sector? Because service sector, again, is a facilitative sector. I mean, unless and it is, the evidence is that when the entire European crisis was happening, Germany was going strong because it's a heavy dependence of manufacturing. Not just services. And all of those countries which has a heavy dependence on service sector somehow is struggling. So service sector will thrive. This is my personal opinion with whatever I have read and exposure that I have with people. Service sector will thrive only and only when the manufacturing does well. So, and if the manufacturing is shying away from the management graduates, what interventions perhaps we need to take up now? So these are some of the questions perhaps. I'm not saying I have answers to it, but these are the relevant questions the management discipline has to address. Okay, now I'll just, I don't know whether I should talk about, because this could be of interest to faculty actually, rather than student. I make it clear this one slide, which is more important to institutes and faculty. And maybe for students, if they are keen on how things are going to be, the grants are going to be disbursed and which institutes are going to be eligible for more grants. So as of now, it's in a draft stage, and perhaps very soon, these are the some of the areas or components which are going to be kind of an eligibility components, so as the institute is eligible for any grants from center, from any, we spoke about Grant Council, we spoke about National Research Foundation. So all of those bodies are going to frame some of the guidelines, and these guidelines will necessarily will look into what the institute development plan is. That is a short-term plan and long-term plan. And when any institution is making a plan, maybe I can have a detailed session later sometime with the faculty or institute, but I'll just briefly touch upon because there are a lot of students over here, or maybe in a question answer we can take. So the institute development plan predominantly has to have these three major components, and that makes the institute more eligible or likelihood of getting all the possible grants to run whatever the development plans or to execute the development plan that they have actually made. So one is the strategic focus area. Now we just spoke about those areas. We spoke about all those areas, right? So those are the most contemporary strategic focus areas. And in what way you are incorporating, and at the same time, how you are actually qualitatively delivering them. That's one of the areas. So like, for example, we are everybody on metros are speaking about smart cities. Like, what possible business school can do a possible intervention in making the in facilitating the establishment of smart cities? Can we have a course on that? Can we have a small program on that? So likewise, what are the strategic focus areas which are contemporary in nature and how they are going to be implemented? That's one of the component. Second is, are we really doing a holistic development of students? Now this, let me dwell into the statistics. For example, in the pandemic time itself, you have come across with a lot of suicides, and suicides by not just by loss of employment, but also by students. And the reasons sometimes, and for our generation, they appear to be very meager. I mean, somebody who doesn't have an internet connection is frustrated to the core and just ends the life. Or somebody who doesn't have a mobile, feels that he's cut off from or she's cut off from the mainstream. And we have heard all of those stories happened in the recent past. In the quest of, I understand completely, in India, where we are a developing country and having huge population, education is not for the sake of knowledge. It is more for the sake of livelihood. We have to keep this in mind whenever, whatever interventions that we do. So when it is for the sake of livelihood, is it that we are putting a lot of emphasis on livelihood and not necessarily doing interventions into building character, in building, because I mean, we all will agree, but people who are into my generations or generations above me, you might have started into one career, like let's say for as a teaching, and you might end up into teaching. You started as an engineer in some manufacturing, you might have end up into engineering. But today, the youngsters, I'm 100% sure that they might start with A and they might end with Z. And in between, they might have several switches, not just the discipline, the functional switches, but also the occupational switches as well as industry switches. So the students, I mean, the youngsters today, there's a lot of uncertainties in the world. And anybody who doesn't make a habit to live with the ambiguity, I guess, going to have a lot of problem in life. Because we always looked ambiguity, uncertainty as a necessary label, and we tried to avoid it, and we have avoided it. But this generation has to not only accept uncertainty, ambiguity as a part of life, but they have to embrace it, and they'll have to make a habit of being with it. So does our education help the student in inculcating such a kind of character? Now, that is what I call as a holistic development. And the last is the social responsibility. Now, we have heard about corporate social responsibility, and to a larger extent, we are doing good because we are the only country which has made CSR as a kind of a mandatory thing. Nowhere in the world that happens. Yes, but that's fine. As an institution, can we have a kind of a socially relevant project like livelihood, like education, which is completely a institute project and which is an ongoing project? It's not a one-time event wherein a student goes, does some kind of campaigning and comes back. No, it's like taking that particular 2-3 villages as a kind of a project and doing all the possible interventions, socio-economic interventions to uplift the village or to uplift the slum or to uplift any other area related to maybe old age or maybe anything. So do we have such a kind of mechanism? If not, can we develop it and can we mainstream it into our education, into our institution? Now, that particular kind of intervention, which will be ongoing, which will have a kind of an outcome, will also be one of the major component which an institute would be eligible for a lot of grants and lots of grant money as well. So these are three major areas. Now, finally, in conclusion, I would just try like to put across that as whatever that we spoke about, the implementation of this particular policy, whatever reform that it speaks about, is going to be very, very crucial, and it is going to be completely dependent, because we have seen at least some 3 or 4 policies that has evolved in the past, and none of the policy had reached to its 100% intent, only because perhaps the loose-hearted efforts of the stakeholders or maybe the ecosystems and the infrastructure were lacking. So I would say that one of the major stakeholders for this kind of policy is going to be the teachers, the faculty members. And if the faculty members are self-sensitized and they really see a kind of a relation between what they do and what the policy really intends, I believe every person in their own capacity, and even for that matter, when I say faculty, I don't undermine student as well, because as for now, what we have done is our education has completely been one-sided in terms of like we decided what a child has to study, we decided how the child has to study, not what they have to study, how they have to study, how they are going to be evaluated, and we finally decide whether the child is successful in life or not, or failed or passed in life. So that's very, very unilateral, that's very one-sided. So this is where perhaps the policy focuses on the student, on the youngsters, as what they want. They should be a part of the particular policy making, and then only perhaps we will be able to reciprocate what is required for today. And in the entire process, one thing we need to completely focus on, because we are a very diverse country, we have issues related to region, religion, and so many other things, and that diversity at many a times has helped us, but at times they have also posed challenges in terms of equity and inclusion. So in our own capacity as an institution, how are we going to reach to this? Anyway, government has, as it is said, that there's going to be a provision of special education zones for SEDG, that is social and economically disadvantaged groups. So there is a lot of interventions in days to come on, particularly because that's one of the major sustainable development goal of the union. And the last is, as I just spoke about, are we going to really build the character? Are we really going to shape up the minds which are more curious? Because in many sessions, when we are into our MBA sessions, I several times used to have this complaint that at the end of the session, we ask for any questions and there are hardly any questions. So does that no questions mean no curiosity? Does that mean no engagement? I don't know, because if you look at our school system, I mean, at least in days and in admin setup, I mean, there's little change, if not significant, little change, because my son is still in school and I can completely get that feeling that how much it has changed. But in school, the habit of asking question is still considered as a kind of revolt, as not as a kind of curious minds. And when they are pushed to the wall and they're impressed on that you're asking question, that means you're doubting the teacher. I mean, such a kind of impression, eventually the child stops asking questions. The child stops being curious over a period of time. And then the same child, when he or she comes to the adult education, that's higher education like us at MBA and all that, how would the child all of a sudden generate that curiosity? Because that's conditioning, that's a social conditioning or classical conditioning. And that has, over a period of time, has fizzled out. So somewhere the intervention of let the child be curious, let they be more compassionate, let them follow what they actually are more naturally inclined to. So this kind of, and that's where we are also very closely working with the school committees as well, because what we get from them, and by the time they reach us in higher education, there are a lot of learning that has happened, and just to make them unlearn thing, it is more efforts than to make them learn. So at the end of the day, there's a very strong thought that John Dewey has put across once, and I feel that summarizes everything just in one sentence. It says that if we teach today as we taught yesterday, we rob our children of tomorrow. How relevant and how perfect it is in this today's time. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, I'll take.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. If questions,
thanks, sir.
I'll stop the screen.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for your knowledge and sharing the knowledge. Now I would request my friends to please raise their hands if they have questions. Abhijit, sir, if you have a question, please unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yes. Good afternoon, sir. I am Dr. Abhijit Chuhne, faculty member here.
Okay.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Go ahead.
Sir, your session was quite nice and we got to know many things about new education policy, because we did not go in so much of details which you have provided us. So okay. One of the questions which I have is that when a candidate shifts from one course to another course, and when it will come to the end of the degree course or any kind of course, how will he be given the degree? Like suppose somebody has done in engineering 1 year and then he shifted to economics in the second year. How does it work about? I did not understand.
I did speak about it, sir. I spoke about it. Somebody who goes through multiple disciplines would be eligible for liberal arts degree. Liberal arts is a very, very old discipline, which I mean, earlier days, there used to be education only in the form of liberal arts. Eventually, we created those segments to make people more specialized in whatever disciplines that they do. So people who are into multiple disciplines will be eligible for liberal arts degree.
But will they complete, suppose, for example, one module he started in engineering, right? Mechanical engineering. And later on, in the second year, he joined economics. Will he complete that course in mechanical?
Yeah, he or she has to accumulate that much of credits. So a degree would be eligible only and only when that person has those required credits. If those number of credits are there, even though there are multiple disciplines, the person would be eligible for liberal arts degree.
Okay. Okay.
So the completion of credits, the completion of number of credits will be required.
Number of credits. And whenever he presents himself, he will have to describe that what did he learn throughout these years, like 3 years or 4 years.
I would say somebody who's making such. I spoke about a case during my session. It's an extreme case. Usually people will go into majors and minors. Practically what would happen is, even though if I'm engineer, I would not leave my engineering, but I will take my minor as economics. If I'm a medicine, I will take my minor as sports psychology. Or if I'm an history student, I'll take my minor as management. So major and minor would actually happen. I mean, I gave a very extreme example. Somebody who completely changed the discipline, not only discipline, but also changed the institutions. Even in that case, there is a provision of liberal arts degree.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Parikshit, sir, I request you to unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes. Sir, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
As usual, it was enlightening listening to you. One thing has piqued my curiosity a little bit. And this is a typical concern that most B schools will have. The current structure of the curriculum is geared to the industry needs. So as an extension to what my colleague Dr. Shivne was asking, is the industry ready? We are looking at forward and backward integration. So is the industry ready for someone who has a variation of qualifications and like you said, possibly a degree in liberal arts? Because current industry requirements, the job descriptions that we see are very specific, 3 years experience or 5 years experience in a particular profile. How does that affect the job market? Because current mindset of the students is, if I do a management program, I will possibly end up with a higher paying job. Like you said, salary is a motivator in India, possibly.
True. Well said, Parikshit. As we are maturing or graduating, I guess our labor market is also maturing accordingly. Now, the other day, I remember, I guess TCS wanted some students in Marathi literature. Now, and they couldn't find 30 good students who are actually good at Marathi literature. What I'm trying to tell you is that what would happen, as I say, when we are graduating as a labor market, I mean industries, first the knowledge industry will like to have a diverse disciplines into the organization, and it started happening now. We still haven't reached to a kind of a situation where Western world is. For example, like a principal like me in US can even apply for a position of general manager with no experience of general management industry, but just an experience of principal. I mean, to that extent, there is a kind of a lateral entry is possible. In India, yes, as I said, education is more for livelihood and less for knowledge as of now. It will take some time for the labor market to evolve and to reciprocate to such a situation. But what I feel is the education should be a kind of a lead interventionist for even for industries to change their policies or to accommodate the skill sets which are deliberated, as long as the skill sets are honestly deliberated and deliberated with intent. So I believe it will take some time. And people, in any case, even though, let's talk practical, even though we make the provisions of switching over, we make the provisions of switching over, not just disciplines and institute, a student will make a informed decision. I mean, at the same time, somebody who's really not, I mean, serious about or really not really worried about employment, such person, if they really want to do, they can keep on changing and do it for the more for the sake of knowledge and less for the sake of livelihood issues. But people who want to really seek livelihood as a major thing, they would try to do it very calculatively. Major, minor, they'll do. And they'll keep that in intact. And as in we progress in days to come, I'm very sure that you would see, I mean, this is my wishful thing, not just wishful thinking, I'm quite sure about it, I would say that we will have a very interdisciplinary kind of recruitment happening in the corporate world. Because you need people from all disciplines to be in the corporate. I mean, this is even the corporate in most of the forum they have been speaking about. So yes, we will take some time as a labor market, and till then the student will take calculated decisions. But as an educationist, we have to start making those provisions instead of like the industry all the time dictating us, this is what we need and this is what we don't need. Rather, when we have the resources into a market, there's a possibility that the industry would also come to a realization, which is already happening in Europe and Western world. Right? So that could be a possibility in days to come. It will happen. I'm very sure about it that is going to happen. Okay. Our labor market will mature to that extent. Yes.
Sir, a couple of more questions.
Okay.
In that scenario, where does it leave the finishing schools that you mentioned corporates have evolved? And secondly, does that mean that the industry may also have to carefully look at the kind of manufacturing or service providing activities they are doing and evolve into something more futuristic?
Yes, I mean, see, manufacturing, if you look at it, the flexibility or the space for a multidisciplinary accommodation is less as compared to services or knowledge industry. Now, talking about finishing schools, I believe finishing school is a kind of it's a kind of a fad wherein as long as the industry feels that their requirements are not met by the institutes, the available institute, they'll get into it. But the moment they see that then with collaborations, the institute itself can do it, perhaps they rely more on, again, education institutes and less on themselves to start a finishing school, which has already started happening now. So finishing school will always be there. Maybe they'll be in the form of, see, finishing school concepts are very clear. We need this customized skills and we need for this much of period. How do we get it? So to inculcate that, this is what the finishing school job is. And this kind of finishing school concept will keep on be there. Only thing is the customized skill sets will change over a period of time. That's what I mean. So today, as I said, for example, TCS wanted Marathi literature people and they couldn't get it. So they started a finishing school, which takes graduates and they would customize their program, just a 6 months program, to get the required Marathi literature people for their jobs. So the finishing school still remains there. Only thing is it changes as per the customized requirement of the skills.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Randhika, sir, I would like to request you to unmute yourself and ask your question.
Thank you very much. Sir, I have a question related to business education. Mm-hmm. I trust the process of transformation is currently on. So out of the people who are involved in it directly as parts of various committees, etc., or who are working on it directly, mm-hmm. what proportion is from the business world or the industry?
You mean to say the task force committee?
Yes. Various committees must be there. People must be working on business education transformation.
Yes. So there is
a committee. What is the current? Go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
Of course. There are multiple committees that are working. Like just like the state government has a task force committee, which just looks into the execution of this policy. We don't have much room to change the policy, collectively we might suggest some changes into it, but simultaneously AICT has come across with two major interventions to study. One is the business school intervention and one is the engineering education intervention. So they are doing it for sure. Who are the members to it? I'm not very sure, but there is a committee that is working on business school interventions vis-a-vis the 2020 NAP 2020 and engineering interventions, both of it. But as of far as our national, task force is concerned, we look at it collectively. We don't go discipline wise. We are completely, and even though if the presence in the task force is multidisciplinary, there are people from social science, there are people from science, there are people from economics, there are people from educationists. Like, for example, the educationist Muzumdar sir is also there. So, there are multiple disciplines. There are people from engineering as well. So I believe there are people from all the disciplines. And I consider to some extent management and economics both.
Yes, sir. I'm sure people from the multiple disciplines would be there. My question was related to the business world.
Are okay, you mean to say practitioners? You mean to say practitioners?
Who are inducted in this?
Industrialist. Okay. Yes, industrialist task force has two representation from industrialist. One is Mr. Hiranandani, who is a part of the task force. And at AICT level, I'm sure there must be people, industry expert. One, and the second is the policy, I didn't touch upon that particular issue. Why we need industrialist is that, because when we were discussing, Mr. Hiranandani also came across with this thought that why is it that the lateral entry is not possible for industrialists into education? Like today, if some general manager having a 25 years of experience, if they have to start a career in academics, they start with assistant professor. So there is also a provision being spoken, I mean deliberated today, just because of that industry representation, that how do we bring in practitioners into education? And does the existing policies doesn't let it happen because of certain guidelines related to qualification framework and so on and so forth. So there is a discussion happening. There's a possibility of lateral entry of industrialists coming into academics in days to come. So that is one part of the discussion, just that came because there is an industry representation on our task force. And likewise, related to curriculum, related to joint projects, there's a discussion happening on various aspects because of the industry representative on the force. Yeah, but yes, okay. Industry representation is very much there, and their thoughts are being incorporated. And because there's a flexibility, because Higher Education Regulatory Council, which is going to dictate the entire structure, rules and regulation related to recruitment, related to qualification, and they're certainly taking care of all those inputs. And perhaps we might see a more flexible, more open kind of recruitment qualification framework in days to come. And that would bring in more industry into campuses.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. Amlan, I would request you to unmute yourself and ask your question.
Thank you, Ankita. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Amlan Dasgupta and I'm a student of TGDM1. Sir, my question to you is that by when can we expect the new education policy to be in action?
There are certain timelines, Amlan, but the final implementation of it is by 2040. So there's a considerable time frame. But yes, there are some milestones that we need to achieve in between. Like I said, de-affiliation has to happen by 2035. The autonomous has to happen by 2030. So likewise, there are timelines, but the final implementation in all its phases and its all its proper features, it has to be by 2040. So that's the timeline.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. By the time you must be a working profession with almost like 15-20 years of service.
Sir, Dr. Shruti here. I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So, sir, firstly, thank you so much for really enriching session.
Okay.
Thanks to bring clarity on this concept. So, sir, my question is related to institutional social responsibility. Okay. So, whenever we think of undertaking any such task, funding is always a problem for us. So, I really like the idea like a village adoption kind of scheme, right? So, okay. Sir, if as an institution, if we want to organize any activity under CSR, so what is the scope of getting funding under this new education policy?
That's what I spoke about. If your institute development plan, that's a perspective plan, if it has a provision for such a kind of intervention, that's a social responsible intervention, there's a more likelihood that you will be eligible for funding, the required funding to execute that particular social project. That's one. But that is still to happen, right? The second is, which actually we did it, if you are right today, because of that Companies Act, we see that 2% of the profit has to be devoted for corporate social responsibility, and companies should have an independent board. But not every company is in a position to create that ecosystem because some company have realized it, some company have realized to the extent that how do we actually bring it into our strategic planning itself so that if not in cash, it will benefit us in kind. So to that extent, they are. But many of the corporates are still really struggling to find out how do we disburse. Let's say, for example, there's an X amount that is a part of my, is compulsory for me to actually do spend on the social responsibility. How do I spend that particular amount? I'm clueless. I mean, or what I do is I look at a very easy options. I bring in some NGO, I write a check to them, I ask them to conduct some program, then hugely invest into preparing a glossy report of it, put it to the book of accounts, and that's how it is done in an ad hoc manner. So this is where I believe an institute can play a major role. What if we do a kind of an need-based assessment study? Let's say, for example, Pirangudi is a place and where they are in the vicinity, there are 2-3 villages. Let's do an assessment, need-based assessment of those villages, and accordingly plan some interventions, right? And then whatever resources required for interventions, and prepare this entire budget and present to some corporate who are actually identify who, which are the corporates. I mean, that we can do it very strategically. We are smart in that. And then we present it to this particular project to this corporate. I'm 101% sure, ma'am, the corporate is going to accept it. I mean, this is my experience. We did it. And not only that, the corporate would see this not just as a kind of they are partnering with you for this particular project, but they see also as an opportunity for the employees to go and actually do a kind of a community service there. And that they consider that as a community, the employee engagement initiative. So it is work. It works on two folds for them. One is they have spent very judiciously the amount. Second is they also have an employee employee engagement initiatives. Because when we say employee volunteering, this is a concept, employee volunteering, where an employee actually takes up a socially relevant project at the cost of the company. At the cost of the company, it's a paid leave. So this employee volunteering, if it is instituted because of this project, that can also act as an employee engagement initiative for the corporate. So I believe it will actually work on two folds. And I don't think that at this point in time, any corporate would shy away from this fact. That can be done till we actually put it to the ministry when the policy gets executed completely.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Sir, I have another question. May I ask, sir?
Yeah, ma'am, please.
Sir, under this NAP policy, there is a plan to set up a new national assessment center. This is PARAC. So, right, sir, could you please throw light on this? Because it's quite interesting.
Madam, we have lots of, entrance exams as well as other exams. And they are, as I said, it is being done on discipline-wise. So the assessment centers is, again, just like we have accreditation, various accreditation agencies. Likewise, we have various assessment agencies, centers, maybe for qualifying something or maybe for admission into something. So likewise, assessment centers would be integration of all of those things.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Diganto, I would request you to unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yes, thank you. Good afternoon, sir. I'm Diganto Chakraborty from PGDM1. Sir, under this scheme of the new education policy, the new guidelines are that there will be a framework of 5+3+3+4 system.
Yes, sir.
So my question is that, and it has also been proposed that the teachers in the regional areas have the eligibility to use local languages as well as regional languages to teach. They have the permission to do that. So right. I think, sir, according to you, sir, will it delay the penetration of English language to the grassroots level of society, as it is the need of the hour for global integration?
That's, I spoke briefly about it when it came to language, actually. Language, there's a lot of debate on language, and it is considered, seen more as an apprehension. But if you look at the policy gives that as an option. Most of the people perhaps have misunderstood that policy is trying to impose to have it in regional language. It's not the case. It's actually an option given. But when I'm giving an option, do I have the necessary resources for it? That's what the organization, the government has to think about. And that's where, if I have to do, let's say there is an engineering college in a remote place of Jharkhand, and if they want to really disperse the engineering into the regional languages, so do I have the content for that? So perhaps first, there is going to be heavy investment into developing the content. So one is about the ecosystem. Now, so the second part of the question is how relevant it would be in today's context, because we are going, evolving as a global village where English happens to be, whether we like or don't like, English happens to be a major language for integration. So there are two opinions that has emerged. As I said, give an option, example to you that even some of the most regional countries in terms of their education have also started English as a language so that the students from their country can be possibly be movable to across the globe. And we at this point in time, we are so some people are thinking, is it a regressive kind of initiative? I would say yes and no, both. Two reasons. We can, if you really have to replicate a formula from, let's say, for example, Korea, or let's say, for example, Japan or something, what they are doing is still majority of their content happens to be in their regional languages. And English happens to be a language of communication, right? So they're not teaching their curriculum in English. They're teaching English as a language so that they don't find it difficult to communicate what they understand and what they know. So likewise, there's a possibility, because it is an evident, it's an empirical fact that anybody who studies in their mother tongue will have a more easiness in terms of comprehension, and maybe the cognitive abilities are far more better than in terms of the other languages. So that's been empirically proved, and that would actually help some of the people into the remotest, because English being always a kind of a big problem, because there's no proper teachers who could teach, and that's the reason students just end up having one subject just for the sake of it, and they never are able to really acquire the skill set. So if somebody who's able to teach in the regional language and they are able to understand the concept, they are able to interpret it, they are able to think about it, they are critically analyze about it, and only when it comes to disseminating what they feel, they have the language as a kind of an assistant, that would work, really wonders. So if at all, if any state or any institution is going regional, I personally feel that they can go regional into their curriculum, but they necessarily need to make their student understand and make them able to speak English. That's going to be more important. And that it would be kind of very deadly combination, I believe.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. So next question is from Isaiah. I'm Ankita from PGDM1. So you mentioned that there in the new policy, maybe we are looking forward for instead of training the process of learning and unlearning and then again learning, we are directly looking for taking the graduates and then training them for 6 months and then working forward. So my question is, if this really happens, so we'll take graduates and then train them for 6 months. That is absolutely good. But where do we see B schools after this?
This is where, Ankita, I thought about that B schools, conventionally, we still are dominant with that degree-based approach. Because, and we are not at fault for that reason, because if you really have to, because the job market, as Parikshit rightly said, the job market, the government, if somebody, let's say, for example, somebody who wants to get into, necessarily into a PSU to work with, and if they don't have a two-year full-time approved program done, they are not eligible to do that. Likewise, some of the corporates which are conventional nature, they also have the similar kind of this thing. So we are doing the two-year kind of program. One that is somewhere is creating, like, let's say, for example, I want to, as I said a little while ago, I want to just do a quick course of 3 months or 6 months in smart cities, which will evolve town planning, which will evolve economics and other discipline, anthropology and all that. And that would really help the stakeholders of smart city. And if I do that, I may be just getting a certificate for it, but I would still not be called as a postgraduate, right? So that somewhere is a big constraint, because we still are thinking conventional because we are forced to, but at the same time, we want to be more relevant. And that's where the conflict is actually. So in this case, what we are supposed to be doing and what most of us are doing, we are getting into two-year program for the sake of that necessity. And then we are simultaneously enrolling ourselves into some other courses which are more relevant. And that's where most of the students, you have those questions many times that, sir, ye to kar rahe, lekin iske saath aur kya kare? So the moment you think that ke saath aur kya kare, that means this particular course is not giving you that. And whatever you wish to do is more contemporary. But you can't just do that. You also need to do this. So there is this conflict, and that's perhaps in days to come, as I said, multiple entries and multiple exits. In days to come, it will also mature. Unfortunately, when it matures, we are not the beneficiaries of it because we're already done with that. So, but in days to come, that will be we will. I'm sure as a management institute, we would have that flexibility. Even as a in days to come, you might see that some government agencies, specifically not necessarily asking only a 2-year program needs to be done, but they would ask that a skill sets of this is nature, and then you are in for interview. So likewise, so in certain industries it's happening, and even it will happen in most conventional industries, including government, in days to come.
Thank you, sir. So I see there is no more questions. So I would like to proceed towards the vote of thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
It's my immense pleasure to present vote of thanks. I, Ankita Yadav from DES, Deccan Education Society's IMDR, would like to thank you for giving us time, enhancing and guiding us on the topic of National Education Policy 2020. So your thoughts and experience knowledge has already inspired us. As you also mentioned, Pune doesn't have JBMs because they have IMDR. So that was a proud moment being a student of IMDR. You also informed us how education policies were set up, how important it is to be knowledge-centric than number-centric, some of the integrated programs, scope of multiple entry and exit in education program, which is actually very much a questionable part for all the students, awareness related to our own education and needs of interdiscipline and curriculum, and also awareness of every field of for management students. The base of knowledge is really helpful for us in our future enroll. Thank you so much, sir. I would also like to thank our director, faculty, non-teaching staff for continuous encouraging and supporting us for such corporate connect. I thank the entire organizing team, technical support, and last but not the least, I would also like to thank my student colleagues without whom the session would have been impossible. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. It's lovely talking to you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.